and we start to build a relationship. And comedy is all about building that relationship.
Welcome to Your Intended Message, the perfect place for leaders and promising professionals who want to convey the intended message for greater success. Every week, we interview experts who address the challenges and best practices to deliver your message effectively. That might be one-to-one, one-to-few, or one-to-many. And perhaps the most important conversation, one-to-self. I'm your host, George Torok.
My guest today is Scott Bloom. Here's three facts that I think you should know about Scott. One, he is a funny, live, and virtual event MC. Two, he's a comedic keynote speaker. Yeah, he makes us laugh. And number three, he is the number one faux author in the world. Scott Bloom, welcome to Your Intended Message.
Thank you, George. Thank you for having me. Good to see you.
Good to see you, Scott. And I'm curious, what makes one a faux author? Because I want to become number two.
Yeah. Well, since I'm the, I don't think there's that many in the actual category. I think like several years ago in my, you know, comedic keynote, I taught, you know, I noticed that, first off, I noticed that there are, you know, every speaker that comes up has a book. So I thought it'd be funny to create these fake book titles and claim that these were books of mine. And so what I focused on was, you know, personal development, professional development, and I created a series of these, what I'm calling faux book covers. And so I would show them and it would get laughs and stuff like that. And then I started posting them on social media. I would write like a little synopsis if this was actually a real book. And because I have a lot of background with reading self-help and professional development, it all kind of sounds like maybe this book is real. And then when posting it on LinkedIn in the beginning, people thought, oh, these are real books, but I was cranking them out once a week. So they sort of caught on to what's going on. And I put together so many of them that I actually put a book together. Can I show the book?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know. So it's called You Can Judge a Book by Its Cover, the fictionalized true story of how I became the number one faux author in the world. And it's a curated collection of my faux book covers, and it released, I think, last December. And it's been great. So I bundle those with my speaking engagements, and it, you know, gives the audience some way to sort of connect to me after the meeting. And it's, you know, part of sort of my brand, which is humor.
And I just wonder how many listeners and viewers caught that, the fictionalized true story.
Right. And then that's the whole thing. The whole book is about parody. Even the foreword, which is spelled F-A-U-X-W-O-R-D, even the foreword makes up this little mythology of how I became a faux author. And people on, you know, on LinkedIn and Facebook, they now look forward and they see a lot of these new covers. In fact, I don't know when this airs, but I'll be posting a new one today.
Now, Scott, you have years of experience as a comedian, a stand-up comedian, a game show host, MC, and you believe your strongest tool in your toolbox is your humor. How do you find humor and how do you use it without offending people?
Right. You know, so I've been performing comedy at corporate events for 25 plus years now. And my act when I did stand up, I haven't done stand up in 20 plus years, but when I did stand up, my act was clean to begin with. But because I have a business background and I had done sales for my dad in college, I sort of knew what the business environment was all about. So I particularly crafted material that was, you know, business oriented, you know, stuff that they can relate to. And, you know, whether it's, you know, their acronyms or the language, the buzzwords, the catchphrases everyone uses. So I built my humor around stuff that they can relate to. And then what I found out was a nice model where I can create a template, a comedic template that I can infuse their language, their acronyms, their material, so that it seems customized, especially for them. And that's what I find out with comedy is they have to be able to relate to the material. And I was never one to just randomly talk about, you know, just observational things. It always had sort of a satiric edge to it. And what's kind of interesting about my comedy is that there's an element of truth in it. And a lot of times you don't know if it's true or not. And that creates that little comedy pocket right there, you know, where people, I might talk about how I speak 18 different languages. I don't. But when I start to speak them, they're like, well, maybe he doesn't, but it turns out he's just, you know, I'm just speaking in an accent or I'm just using certain words. So I try to customize the humor to the audience. And it's a great way for me to connect with them, relate to them. And as you know, humor is you know, laughing and comedy, it's an emotional experience. And that's what I believe every speaker needs to do is make that emotional connection. I use, you know, humor and comedy to do that.
And do you find the corporate world just so full of material to laugh at?
Well, there's definitely lots of stuff. You know, what's great is I can say a lot of things that are on the attendees' minds that maybe the executives or the leadership team can't talk about. So I can reference things that are in their life that they're would be making fun of maybe on their own, you know, with each other. So there's definitely a lot of stuff in that corporate world, and that's why it allows me to, you know, really have these connections with the audience, because I become sort of an insider. I do a lot of research beforehand, get as much material as I can, and they appreciate. I mean, that's one of the things I talk about in my keynote, is making an effort for another, you know, finding a way to connect with them. And by talking about the things they experience, that they know, it doesn't look like, oh, I just showed up with this bag of tricks I use for every company. I made this specific for you. So they appreciate the time I put in, and we start to build a relationship. And comedy is all about building that relationship.
I'm curious, the comedy that you use when you're speaking for a corporate event, how might the people there take ideas from that and take it back to the workplace? How might they harness your comedy?
Yeah, I mean, it's I think almost harnessing the process. You know, they see, you know, especially salespeople, they see for some reason we like this guy. We're connecting to this guy. What is he doing that makes us want to, you know, listen to him? We're enjoying what he's having to say, and it's because I've done that sort of research and have material and they see the effort. And what I'm hoping is that they see that, oh, if you make it about the other person, and, you know, with comedians in the early years of growing as a comedian, it's all about you. You know, in fact, let's face it, most performers, it's kind of all about me. And I write in my faux book covers, I write a lot of narcissism type books there. I mean, there's no, let me see. Yeah, like this one, I know they can't see it, but this one is called Egos Are for Winners, Putting Narcissism at the Top of Your To-Do List as You Send Everyone Else to the Bottom. And there is a, you know, a performers can be very, you know, self-centered, single-minded, thinking on stage, hey, it's all about me getting the laughs. But when you take the attention off you as any presenter, as any speaker, and you put it on the audience, they can feel that. Because what it does is allows you to be less self-conscious, allows you to be more in the moment. And they can feel that. And they feel that also by the material that you're presenting and how you're relating to them. So that I think that's an important thing with presenting and building that relationship. Because it's all, I mean, as a speaker, it's all about building that relationship. And some speakers do it very well. Some people have that canned presentation. And even though they might have been on a ride where things were going well, you know, there's a point where they can kind of feel like you're phoning it in. So it's real important to be in that moment, and with comedy especially.
Scott, you've been a keynote speaker, you're an event MC, game show host. Those are different skill sets, I imagine. How do you transfer from one to another? How do you connect with people differently, perhaps, or what are the challenges?
You know, most of my, you know, I might have mentioned this when we were talking before that, you know, I got into this business, into the corporate side as a game show host. You know, I was a comedian. They wanted someone who was able to ad lib, be on their feet, be spontaneous. So that is the core of everything I do, is trying to be in the moment. You prepare, and then you're in the moment. So it allows me to not only create comedy that I've presented, but also, or, you know, that I prepared, but also things that happen in the moment. So even in my keynote, which is written, but there's lots of rooms for improvisation. There's a lot of audience interaction. And there's the moments where I can actually literally connect with the audience, that they see things are being created, you know, in the moment. You know, when I first started doing stand-up, I think I started back in 86. So I've been doing comedy a long time. There was a comedian who said to me that all the material that's written looks like it has to be made up just on the spot. And ironically, the stuff that is improvised looks like, oh, that's written. And it's that kind of keeping the audience off balance. Like, I mean, everyone knows at some level, the comedian that's presenting their material, they've worked on it, it's written. But it feels like they're just coming up with it. And that's what makes it alive. So whether it's a keynote, whether it's hosting a game, it's about that energy, that give and take, that flow between the presenter or the performer on stage and the audience. So I think they're all sort of somewhat connected.
Now I'm curious about the improv part, that part where you need to be in the moment because you don't necessarily know what's going to happen next. You don't know what the audience is going to do or say. Mm-hmm. How do you get yourself through those uncertain moments where you're between the trapeze?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's, you know, the net is the preparation. So if you're prepared, you have everything at your, you know, at your disposal. You can go left, you can go right. You pretty much know the direction you're going. And as I said, even stuff that might even sound a little improvisational, I might have said it at some other time. So you create that sort of edge. But you're never going out in an area, you know, with what I do in improv, and especially in a corporate environment. I always know the lane, the path I'm going down, and so I might move a little to the left, I might move to the right, but I'm not gonna go off an exit and go somewhere where I haven't gone before. So I'm always in control. What's coming, you know, what's going to come up next. And there's a difference between spontaneity and just making something up out of the blue. You know, when I create, so I've been doing these virtual tips, you know, since it's, you know, something that's very important now. And I found a great way for me to write comedy. So when I'm writing comedy, I'll get in front of the camera. I will have an idea. I'll improvise it. It's what stand-ups do in the comedy clubs. But unlike, you know, comedians who can go to a club and try out things, and when I'm on stage, it's got a hit. And there becomes sort of a confidence and intuitiveness that you know what's going to work. You feel, you kind of know what's going to work, but you still have to work it out. So when I'm writing comedy for video, I'll have an idea, I'll have some beats, you want to beat it out, you know, this is what you're going to do. And then you play on things. And, you know, the final video, even though it's, I have a direction where I'm going, the moments that hit the hardest are the ones that just came up in that moment. So I'll do that in video because I have 7-8 takes. I would never do that, you know, on stage. And that's the interesting thing about being a comedic performer in a corporate environment, is that you don't necessarily get chances to try it out. You can't try it out in front of an audience of 1,000 people. So you have to kind of almost intuitively know this is funny. You feel it after a while. And so that's kind of the fun of it. I mean, I'm having a great time right now. You know, now that we're in this sort of new medium, doing all this other stuff. I'm used to having an audience of people and they let me know if things are funny. I'm used to having a crew if I'm doing, you know, TV or broadcast. I'm alone now. I mean, I might have a TD with me. I have a camera guy who travels with me, travels from my kitchen into my family room. That's what travel means. But I kind of know what is gonna work. I work it out. And then when I'm on stage, most of the time, 95% of the time, it's going to work because I know it's funny. And then it just gets better as you do it over and over.
Scott, I'm wondering what transition you went through it during this pandemic, because I'm seeing right now that and I've seen in your videos that you put out energy. You put out energy to the audience, and you get it back, and I believe that feeds you to keep going. But here you are in this environment where you still need to put out energy. In fact, maybe even more energy, because the camera kind of, you know, kills the energy. So how do you keep yourself fed when you're not getting it back from the audience? And did you go through a deep depression trying to figure out no one's clapping?
Well, yeah, I think we all did. All of us performers, presenters, comedians. You know, at first, you know, when this happened, you know, forget about trying to get work and all the cancellations and postponements. Okay, that's fine. Now you have to do something different. It was everything from not having an audience, not, you know, a lot of the humor I did was interactive. I have no people here in my, I forget about a studio. I didn't even have a studio then. Back then it was, you know, paying black market prices to get a decent, you know, webcam. You know, I spent like five times as much. But before that, I was using my Mac laptop, and I didn't realize how bad it was until I saw that there was something better. We just didn't know. So I, in the beginning, yeah, it was really, really tough. And anyone who doesn't say that is not really telling the truth, especially the comedians out there, someone who needs that sort of energy and feedback. So, you know, there was two things that had to, you know, get to a place where I felt comfortable. One was this sort of medium of just, you know, talking to the camera and connecting. And what is that energy level? You know, because TV, film, video is a very intimate thing. But you can't just, you know, lay back and just kind of talk. So I was trying to find that balance. You know, is this too big? You know, I'm big on stage. There's lots of energy. Is that going to be too big? And so I started to, you know, yes, there was a lot of fear, a lot of nervousness going through this process. And I went through it. And it took some time to build up what I have here today, which was going from even, you know, even things like, you know, my first virtual gig was a global Pfizer product launch. And everyone on the team was doing it kind of for the first time. And as far, you know, and they're saying, you figure it out, you know, so I had to, get a little mini prompter screen, a little tiny thing. It was like this big, and I put my iPhone on it, and I had to run it myself. And I'm used to people running prompter, running camera. So it went from that to eventually building up and actually creating a studio that I have now with full lights, camera, prompter, a decent mic. So that was the technical side. And then the other side was just to get comfortable again. And even though I've done broadcasts and television, I've hosted TV in the past, and I've done broadcasts at internal situations with company with training and stuff like that. There are always people to run prompters. So I was getting used to running that. And then finding out what comedy works in this kind of, you know, medium. And what I found out is it was going back to what I always believe was you sort of intuitively know that's funny. And so you stop relying on the audience and you start to go, okay, this would be a funny bit. And you're talking about maybe what is going on in the virtual world. You're talking about things that relate to them. Some of the material that I did live on stage wouldn't work in this scenario. So it's crafting it for this particular medium. It's finding a way to engage. Engaging is, and finding ways to be spontaneous. You know, you have a script as an Emcee, as a virtual Emcee. I have a continuity script. I know I'm introducing people, I'm transitioning. And then they ask me, hey, can you find some way to have a little engagement in the audience? And I find gamification, that's a big buzzword these days, is a great way to do that because you have a give and take and a back and forth. And then finding other ways to be engaging, be likable, and make it still about them. So it's still about getting material about them and talking about them. So it's been a journey, you know, for sure.
Scott, in your role as a virtual Emcee, what would you say are the main benefits that you bring to a corporate event that they're holding a virtual event? It could be an award ceremony. It could be a kickoff meeting for a project. Could be a celebration of an award or the end of a project. What benefits do you bring in your role as a virtual emcee?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, a lot of us event hosts have moved into this virtual space. And, you know, once again, it's the professionalism, it's the experience. You know, for me, it's my broadcast, you know, background, bringing humor and lightness to it and comfortability. You know, what happens, what's interesting when I'm on stage and also doing these virtual things, as the, not just the audience, but even the presenters, as they see the comfortability that I have on stage, they see how the audience is relating. I mean, an interesting thing that happens at live events is, once I give the audience permission to laugh, and that we sort of shift the tone, this is not going to be one of these boring meetings where, you know, you're just going to have speaker after speaker, that there's going to be some sort of entertainment factor. There's going to be some sort of energy that's different, you know, from past meetings. You see the presenters start to free up a little bit. They're like, hey, I can do this too. So it's not about me being in a position where I'm intimidating the presenters. It's they're like, hey, maybe I can do that too. He seems to be very loose and open. So it's that comfortability factor, being comfortable on camera and being able to really, you know, connect with them just on, you know, knowing where you're going to go, the direction you're headed, and feeling good about and feeling excited about being there. So I think it's part of, you know, engagement and just be, as I said, being spontaneous and funny in virtual is really a lot more of ad-libbing. It's how you deliver the material. And once again, just being present, it's all about the preparation. So I prepare a lot. I'm there. I'm ready to go.
Scott, you and I are both familiar with making that transition from, you know, in live performances to virtual performances. And we understand the whole performance concept, but what about for business leaders who now need to lead virtually? What tips or ideas can you give them to help them be more effective when they're working with their team?
Yeah, so I mentioned I put out this series of virtual tips, and they're humorous tips, but a lot of the comedy that I do, there's some truth still in it. So even though I'm talking about being big and bold, and I think that was one of the last tips I put out, you're not going to go as crazy as I go in that video. But there are things about you have to, you know, first of all, look at this as a professional environment. Some people, you know, it's literally, you don't have to have a green screen. You don't have to, you know, have a full studio, but be conscious of things like, hey, you're presenting to someone. So have a decent backdrop. It's a year into it. I think people have gotten that. Also, it's, you know, dress for that you're doing this meeting. You don't have to be, you know, in a suit and a tie. But, you know, you also can't just roll out of bed and just sort of deliver it. So same preparation you would give in, you know, in a presentation that you would do live. You'd want to do that virtual. You also want to have enough of that, you know, enough of this preparation that you can be a little bit more relaxed. So you need to be energized. You need to be relaxed. You need to actually try to as best you can to have that relationship with the camera. I mean, they talk about that in television film and how important it is. But you have a little screen there. I know someone who puts like a little happy face. Is that you, George? Did you tell me you do that? Or someone told me recently. Yep. Somebody, it's you, George. Yeah. And so that you're smiling, you're having a good time. You know, the ones who are, and you know, I understand you might have a presentation and you might not have a prompter, and so your lot's on a screen, but you can't just stare at a screen and blah, blah, blah. You know, you have to know it. And it's better to have bullet points if you can, because you have to relate to these people. They have many options. I mean, I even do a joke when I'm doing virtual about, look, we know you have many options. We're just one web browser. We want you to stay here. And just to make sure that you do, they've actually hooked up electrodes to me. So if you switch, whoa, that hurt. Okay, whoever's watching Tiger King right now, could you come back, please? Because I get a little, they said it wasn't going to be that painful. They said it was going to be a slight shock, but that was a good 100 volts. Appreciate that. So you're competing about with so much stuff. You know, they're asked to watch a screen for sometimes hours. You have to find a way to engage them.
Here's an interesting phrase, two phrases that I found on your website, and I'd like you to tell us about the connection between them. And the phrases are this: the power of laughter, the language of business. So what, tell us what the connection is that you see between those two concepts.
Well, it's for what I do in the corporate environment, it's about talking their language, you know, whether it's, you know, their, whatever their language is, talking their culture, letting them feel like you're an insider. I mean, sometimes I'm hosting an event and they just think I'm a really good speaker from their company. I mean, even though they might have said, you know, he's from this and he's from that, you need to feel like an insider. Because a lot of these live events, and it might even happen with virtual, there are a lot of these companies that I've been doing events for them 4, 5, 6 years. I think I did one for like 7 years. And it's because they look forward to seeing me again. There's this relationship that we built, you know, in that first time. And I think that's you know, very important. So the power of laughter is something that opens people up, engages people. It's you know, just laughing is healthy. It feels good. Endorphins rise. And with laughter comes an openness. And when you're open, then you can actually deliver content to them. So I'm there sort of as the, you know, besides being a palate cleanser in between, you know, speakers, I'm there also to, you know, bring them back into the experience, open them up so they can receive all this information. So that's the power of laughter. And the language of business is talking, you know, their language. My keynote is about, is entitled Laugh, Learn, Connect, Repeat. And the experience is a laughter-filled experience, but I'm really talking about how to connect better, not just to your audience as a presenter, but how to, as your salesperson, how to connect to the people you're dealing with, whether it's coworkers or customers and clients. And that's where I re-emphasize through the material that I'm doing that it's really, once again, taking the attention off of you and making the experience all about them. When they feel special, they bond to you. And that's what I do as a virtual MC. That's what I do as a live presenter. That's what I do as a comedic keynote speaker. It's about connecting to them and making them feel, and genuinely, that this is a special experience. I want to be here and I want to do this for you.
Now, I'm curious about that concept of taking the attention off you and putting it on your audience. I think it's important, but here's my question. How might corporate leaders apply that principle in their team meetings? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it's about humanizing yourself. You know, I mean, I think that's, you know, great leaders make things, you know, they share, it's about sharing information, you know, about yourself, you know, not holding back. As you open up, other people open up. You know, it's getting off that on top of that ivory tower and coming down to be with them so that they feel that they have a relationship. Now, there's always going to be a hierarchy. There's always going to be a paradigm between management and the people or the team leader. But you need to be open. That's an important thing. You need to share, feel comfortable sharing. Once you share with them, they feel more comfortable sharing with you. And that's where the relationships, you know, starts to build. So I would say, you know, for team leaders or presenters, the more you open up to someone else, the more you let them see that this is an important relationship, they'll respond, you know, in the same way. The more you open up, they'll open up more, and then there's a stronger connection. It's all about that connection, that bond that you're trying to create, whether it's team leader and team members or speaker and an audience.
A reminder to our listeners and viewers to learn more about Scott and contact him directly. You can reach him at scottbloomconnects.com. There's no spaces there, and scottbloomconnects.com, and there'll be a link in the description as well. And that is Scott with two T's, Bloom with two O's, and Connects with two N's. scottbloomconnects.com. Scott, in wrapping up here, let's assume you're talking to an overworked business leader who's got a meeting with their team tomorrow. Perhaps it's the weekly meeting, the monthly meeting, and the meetings have been pretty boring lately. They're not a comedian. They're not a virtual MC. But what one or two ideas might you offer them to make this next meeting just a little bit more comfortable and engaging for their team?
Well, I mean, I guess there's a couple of things that they can do. First of all, maybe starting it a little bit differently. Maybe it is going on the internet and finding, some sort of icebreaker game to build sort of camaraderie. So it's not just about me talking as the leader and all of you listening. Find a way to engage them. I mean, there's a little game that I sometimes play with people called Fact or Fiction. It's a common icebreaker game, two truths and a lie. You send out an email. Tomorrow we're going to find out some information about some of you folks that maybe you haven't shared. We want to get to know you better. You're going to get to know everyone on the team better. And what I want you to do is to come up with two things about yourself that maybe this group doesn't know about you. And you decide what you want to share and one you made up. And you'll present it to them, and then the people on the call, if it's a small meeting, we'll vote on what we think is right. We'll get an answer from you, and maybe you can tell us a little bit about the story. So it's a great device to get the people to talk about themselves, to just even talk in general. And so that's a great way for a team to sort of bond together. And I think it's looking at this, a lot of people have Zoom fatigue at this point. It's to wake up and go, hey, I can do this differently. I was talking to my brother, and his boss was talking to all their salespeople who deal virtually with their customers. And he commended them for just taking a more professional approach. So it's, whether that was, people looking like they're dressed ready for a meeting. Maybe if you've, maybe if you've kept it really casual, just yourself, we're just sort of going through it. Look like you're delivering, a meeting. This is an important meeting. Put some energy and effort into this next one. You'll surprise yourself. The audience, your team is going to see you a little bit differently. They're going to have a new respect. And it is watching, maybe just watching some other people that are out there and seeing what they're doing. And you'll see that they're not just sort of sitting back and dreading going through it. They're excited to be there. So be excited about being there. Be there for them. And once again, try to share some stuff with them that they feel like, hey, we're getting to know you, and we're getting to know them, and have that a little bit more of that exchange. I think that would help out tremendously.
My guest today is Scott Bloom, reminding you to take the focus off yourself and put it on the audience.
If you like what you heard, remember to like, comment, and share this podcast. Come back every week for more practical insights to help you deliver your intended message. I'm your host, George Torok.